This is the April 18th meeting of the Conway Select Board. First item on our agenda, minutes from the April 10th meeting. Has everybody reviewed the minutes?
Yeah.
Any corrections or amendments? No? Okay, I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes for the April 10th meeting. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Next item on the agenda is we have three warrants. We have a vendor warrant for $166,076, a payroll warrant for $100,044, and a payroll deduction warrant of $25,994. I'll make a motion that we approve those warrants.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
All right, meetings attended by select board members.
I had no meetings this week.
No meetings.
Although, at this very moment, there's a housing committee meeting going on that I'm supposed to be at, but because our meeting is on Tuesday.
Doesn't count.
So, anyway.
Okay. Okay, last Tuesday I was at the Massachusetts Municipal Association Board of Directors meeting in Boston. We had some conversation about a number of things, including the fact that state revenues are coming in well behind what they expected.
Oh no!
So that's going to be a problem in the last quarter of the year. There was also some talk on the up and coming changes to the marijuana law and regulations, which is quite confusing all around. So that was kind of interesting. In the afternoon, I had a meeting with the local government advisory commission. We had the lieutenant governor there, and Sean Cronin, Secretary Cronin, and a couple of other secretaries talking about the items that are in before the legislature that affect municipalities and how we might affect some of that legislation so that it doesn't disadvantage us. Then also in the afternoon, I had a meeting of the Massachusetts Selectmen's Association Board, and we were looking at what we're going to do for the fall conference and the meeting coming up in June. So that was Tuesday.
It was
a long day in Boston.
Yeah.
But a lot of good information. Okay. Next item, citizens' concerns. Do we have any citizens' concerns? No, I guess we don't.
I have one.
Okay. Oh, you do.
Okay. I'm not a citizen. You know, well, yes, I'm a citizen.
But citizens' like compliment.
Go ahead.
This was brought to me by a concerned citizen who said, you better go down and walk the ball field and look for slate debris all over the grass down there. And I just came back before I came in here. And this is one of thousands of pieces on the grass down there.
That got blown
off
the church roof.
And if our ball field kids fall down on the grass,
sure,
on that, they're gonna be bleeding like you wouldn't believe.
Wow.
So what I think we need to do immediately is get somebody that's gonna come in, they gotta sweep that field. Not by hand, but a power sweeper or something.
Yeah.
I don't know if Ron has room for the highway department or not. They can do that.
Well, we'd have snows do it probably.
You can have something in the pan that picks it up as soon as you don't want to pick it up and just keep windrowing it. But it's from the driveway down to the right, to the left, I mean, all the way along that bank and all the way over into the ball diamonds. And there's a lot of it like that. That's off the church roof, I guess, and stuff like that from the tornado.
Yeah. Tom, so, you want to coordinate with Parks and Rec on that?
Yeah, and Ron, who's managing the grounds,
but
too.
This needs to be get done ASAP, because they're going to be having ball games down here next week.
They start in May, don't they?
Yeah.
It's a couple of weeks.
Well, we're practicing.
I wouldn't want to be running around in barefoot if I was in pain.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Bob. Okay, no old business, new business. Letter of support for the feasibility study for the Franklin County Regional Emergency Communications Center.
Yeah, first we heard about was a letter from the COG saying we want to do a study to look at the possibility of including Greenfield and Montague in the regional consortium and combining the dispatch, because they have their own dispatch.
Right.
And as far as I know, that is a study. On the other hand, I do know that one of the reasons that Greenfield and Montague would be interested is if dispatch could move to Greenfield. So then we got a letter from the, which I think you have,
from the
Oversight Committee of the Shelter and Control, saying we don't think that the established place, which is also, they don't actually point this out very very firmly, but it is the state police barracks in Western Mass, aside from, you know, Orange, I think. Or is it Gardner or Orange?
What's that?
The next state police barracks.
Other than here?
Yeah.
Northampton.
Oh, well, Northampton, yeah. But for northern...
But east.
For the northern tier. Shelburne is the state police headquarters, and of course some towns do rely, many towns, including Conway, rely on the state police for coverage at times when local police coverage is not sufficient. So they are wanting to stop this study in its tracks, assuming that it is going to have as one of its possible endpoints moving the dispatch to Greenfield. Doesn't necessarily mean it shouldn't be studied, but they see that that's where it's leading, and they don't even want to go that far. So that's how I read the letter. Mm-hmm. That's how I read the original study proposal, which of course puts itself as just a study. We're not talking about taking any action at this point. We just want to find out what the situation is. And there's, you know, usually nothing wrong with finding out what the situation is, but often that can lead to change. And so there's some preemptive action to keep that from happening.
All right, so what was FERCOG's motivation for this study in the first place? Who brought it up to them?
I think it's been a topic of conversation for some years to have Greenfield and Montague brought into a regional dispatch system.
The Greenfield Police Chief is the one supporting it.
And from what I understand. Yeah, and I think it's been talked about for a long time. And of course, the COG is sort of the regional government entity, so they were the ones who would be doing the. At least, you know, overseeing the study.
Montague and Greenfield do their own dispatch now?
Yes.
Okay. And everybody else uses Shelburne Control?
Shelburne Control, yep.
And Shelburne Control works fine?
Yeah,
that's fine. Well, I haven't heard any complaints about it.
No, it's just a question of, you know, if we were to regionalize, mm-hmm. would it make sense? If Greenfield and Montague were to join in, since they presumably generate a large number of the calls,
right.
would it make sense? Would it make more sense to have the dispatch in Greenfield? I don't know.
I think
I don't even know what the questions are about.
Well,
so.
One question I think would be that if they were to consolidate onto one and move to Greenfield, there's a possibility the state police would say, "Okay, we're stopping all the funds on it. Now you people are all going to pay for your own dispatch services." Which could be thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars a year. And I think that's why Greenfield and Turner and Montague are looking at wanting to swap over to somebody different, because it's killing their budgets.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, that's one of the things that a study would
right.
identify. So it's, you know, a lot of...
And I know that the dispatch center, our dispatch center, has made statements that it's probably if they were to try to move them into there, if they were with us, they would have to hire a minimum of two more people per shift to maintain the extra workload.
In Shelburne?
In Shelburne.
So
the state police, yeah. Who knows what the state police think about that, seeing they're paying the whole bill now.
So after this letter came in, which was late last week, I thought maybe the best thing to do would be to try to get representatives from both organizations to come in and explain their positions before you made before you try to make any kind of a decision.
Yeah, we'll do that. We'll table this for now. We won't make any recommendation on this.
I'm surprised you can get both of them recommended.
Either that or until we get some more information.
Because they had, Greenville had a general meeting of all the members of the dispatch center two weeks ago in Greenville, at the Greenville Fire Station. They flooded the place with people. That's when they laid their recommendations on everybody.
And you were there?
No, two deputy chiefs went to it.
Okay.
It was on a Monday night. We had a suckers meeting.
Okay.
So I sent them both to it. And from what consensus I got, a lot of people there weren't happy with it.
Okay. The proposal for consolidation.
Right.
Okay. All right.
Well, even if they wrote a report, that would be helpful. But, I mean, the problem is we don't have Greenfield's side of it.
Mm-hmm.
We only have the oversight board side of it,
mm-hmm.
and then our own experience.
Yeah, he can ask them to come in.
So if we can't get Greenfield to come in, it'd be interesting to hear what they heard at that meeting.
Yeah, well, I want to get somebody from the Shelburne Control Advisory Committee and somebody from the COG mm-hmm. to come in
yeah.
and,
if we, that'd
and
be great.
Talk about it.
Yeah, but how about Greenfield? They're the ones pushing it.
Well, I think the COG can represent their point of view.
The COG can represent their point of view, but that's not Greenfield's side of the point of view.
Well, Greenfield's isn't necessarily Montague's either, and I don't think we want too many people yeah. in the meeting.
Well, maybe get somebody else.
All right, we'll table that for now.
I'll see if the COG's comfortable with doing that or whether they want somebody from Greenfield.
I would be surprised if you aren't going to see a majority of people, unless just me saying this, that are going to vote in favor of Shelburne Control's letter. This letter.
Well, in this letter, it's saying it's a waste of money to spend the, you know, to do the study.
Right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody comfortable just tabling this
sure.
for now? Okay. All right. Next item on the agenda is the sign the agreement showing of town-owned paintings by Lester Stevens. Okay.
That would be us.
You guys are on.
That'd be nice.
So Peter Engelman, I'm the president of the Historical Society, and Phil Cantor, who was past president of the society, and it was his idea to do the Lester Stevens exhibit, and I'm heading up a committee that the society put together. It's part of the 250th celebration, so we're going to have the exhibit in the Field Library from June 15th, Thursday, opening night, and 16th, 17th, 18th. And it'll coincide with all the other activities in town. And the town owns 8 paintings, so we're hoping you'll sign the loan agreement so we can have those paintings prominently displayed. There's about 30 altogether that we're going to have on display.
Notice how the loan agreement is all proper and museum-like and sophisticated.
Very sophisticated.
Yes.
Very sophisticated.
We do have insurance. We've got a policy with Liberty Mutual through Berkshire Insurance Group. It's covering all the paintings in the exhibit.
Because it's private property.
Where are they now? Where are the paintings now?
Well, the town paintings?
It's
but one is here in the next room, and the other 7 are in the grammar yeah. school, except for one I brought because it was in the library in the grammar school and the frame fell apart and they had it wrapped up in a closet for
yeah.
who knows
yeah.
how long it's been there. So they sort of handed it off to us and said, do what you can with
fix it.
so we got it reframed, and I can show you. If
oh,
you
great. But the Historical visual. Society did that on its own.
Right. So we
as a gift
to
the
that.
Town so that it can be returned to the children for their viewing enjoyment.
That is nice for people.
Isn't it?
We'll think about all the bad things we said about it.
So we own these paintings.
Yes, yes.
And we're just going to lend them to the Historical Society
yes.
for an exhibit.
Yes.
So that's a Lester Stevens landscape.
Mm-hmm. Very nice.
And it's been hanging in the grammar school library for who knows how many years. I forget when these paintings arrived there, or given to the library, or given to the grammar school.
So town. None of them were in people's homes around town.
You know, I don't. Do you know, Phil, the story of how these paintings ended up in the grammar school?
I know that at least some of them were given directly by Mr. Stevens to the town.
They hung in the old grammar school.
And several of them have plaques that you know, he framed them I and put a plaque questions. On them from him and his wife to the town.
And where is that?
These have all. So those are all scenes from Conway.
And
It's hard to say. It looks like it.
See, and he was sort of famous for blending realism with impressionism, and he would move things around. When you look at the exhibition, he's doing Main Street, but he would move buildings, take out the utility wires. He would
artistic license.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. And so his images, you know, what he did of Mag's Barn, the one he did of Mag's Barn, what it looked like in 1960, mm-hmm. whatever is great, and we're going to be showing too.
This number 8 painting you got here, run trail oil cameras in the town hall. Is that the one that hangs over the fireplace?
Yes. Yeah, this is actually
we cannot vote office. On that one because it's not owned by the town of Conway.
It's not.
Nope.
Who owns it?
County Firemen's Relief Association owns it, and we got it down here just as being stored in a safe place.
Oh. Okay. So who do we get in touch with?
We're gonna call Chris Herman.
Chris
Herman.
Herman.
He's a president.
Right.
From right up, right up here in Conway.
Yeah.
Chris Herman.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're right down the road. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
All right. So what we're really doing here. So we're giving these paintings to the Historical Society from the 15th to the 18th of June of this year to display in the library. That's right. All we're doing here.
And that is actually the 14th, because that's when we're going to hang the day before.
The 14th, that's
fine. You get it back the 19th on Monday.
Right, and it comes back on that Monday.
Are you having many more other paintings from it besides these?
There's 30, about 30 altogether.
Oh.
Yeah, so mostly Conway owners, a few... Mm-hmm. Come outside. Deerfield Academy, Greenfield Savings Bank had a couple. The Historical Society has a couple.
How did you locate them?
We had a notice in the Visitor and word of mouth.
Mm.
And we're hearing about more of them now. We don't have room to show anymore. Mm-hmm. But every week now we're getting calls and emails from people saying, I have a Lester Stevens too. A lot of them are not of Conway. We're trying to include only ones that focus on Conway or Western mm-hmm. Mass.
I have a question. Have you considered taking high quality photographs of them and perhaps making posters available as a fundraising possibility?
We did talk a little bit about that. It's expensive to mm-hmm. do it well, so we're a little worried about costs at this point. We do have a budget, but it's very easy to run over that budget mm-hmm. because of insurance, transportation. The whole bit, it's starting to add up. The brochure, we're going to put a brochure together, maybe some kind of an information card that's available.
But you can have a sign and say, if you're interested in more than 3 people or some number.
If there's anybody that wants to volunteer and be part of the committee and do a project like that, that would be...
Right.
Like that. We are a small number, and there is a fantastic amount of work involved in this that I had never... conceived of when I thought this was a good idea.
Yeah, snowballing on us.
Is there a professional photographer in town that is known to people who might take the photographs?
There might be,
part of the problem is that so many of the pictures are, it's just one picture from one owner in one living room,
right.
And it would be many home visits to get, we're not getting the paintings to right before the exhibition and then it's too late.
Well, maybe it would be handier to have them all in one place to have somebody photograph them.
But then there'd be a lag time when you could actually get an image of it, right? It would be after the exhibit.
Well, if it didn't turn out to be financially feasible, you might never print them, but at least you'd mm-hmm. have the electronic... Right.
I guess as long as we didn't have to pay the photographer a lot.
Well, that's why I asked if there was
something. And then there's a rights issue,
might,
too. We'd have to get permission from all the owners.
Yes, but we do have that written permission includes
the town permission to use it
for publicity purposes.
Would be, Oh, okay, and that's the same one that other people are...
Yeah, everybody's signing that.
Normally the pictures are taken mm-hmm. by the gallery that also makes the the print, and they do color matching.
We're the gallery.
And...
Right. Yeah,
that's the problem. But
No, I mean like the art gallery in Greenfield, they specialize in print.
Right.
But they also take the picture and color match and
right.
Well, I just asked the question if there was a photographer in town.
There's a fancy glossy slick art magazine called the American Art Review. like this stick that comes out, but it's sort of the Bible of fancy fine arts magazines, and they're doing a 4-page spread on this exhibition.
Nice.
And they wanted to run, they're doing 3 pages of text, I just talked to you, and 12 pictures. And so...
Perhaps we could get copies of the
It's going to be, the magazine, when it comes out, they're going to be sending a lot of copies to us.
Like original photographs, especially if they're electronic. That would be very handy for us to have.
They would be digital. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I ended up doing it with
I shouldn't say this, but I think the 250th committee has a photographer on board. I think. Mm-hmm. Take pictures. And he's a resident Conway. It's Adam Karen.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
He does professional paintings and weddings and all that little stuff. Mm-hmm. And I know he's the one that took a whole bunch of tornado pictures. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he did a nice job.
And if he's doing some 250th pictures, which I presume he probably would be, that maybe I'll talk to him about making sure he takes some pictures of those.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Tom, can we get another copy of this? We got just one.
There aren't two
there.
There
you go. Yeah.
We got another one in?
I have one.
You got one?
Yeah.
Okay, good. There we go.
So one of the neat things about this. So one of the neat things about this whole thing.
Let me have that.
Tom.
Tom.
Hang on. Here you go.
Okay. Good.
Yeah. That's not going to be an original signature from them, but that's all right.
That's okay. So one of the neat things about this is Lester Stevens moved out here in 1944 when he was already painting for 3 decades. But he was born in Rockport, Massachusetts, and he was the founder of the Rockport Art Association, which is a serious North Shore cultural whatever. When the Rockport artists found out that we were mounting this show, and they wanted to get involved, and they've been coming out. So there's 15 artists associated with the Rockport Art Association, really serious heavyweight names. Mm-hmm. The president of it, that have about half of them have been here already, that are painting Lester's house or in Cricket Hill area with the permission of Dean Lee and the current residents. Mm-hmm. And in the style of Lester Stevens. And they will be, each one of them will be exhibiting one of their paintings. And these are people that sell for really high dollar. And they're bringing a whole lot of publicity and everything else. And that's right. The reason why it's in the American Art Review, because of their involvement in it. So it's the sort of the greatest living artists in New England, like commercially at least.
Paying tribute major
to
influence
to
in
the one.
So their paintings will be in the library also?
Yes.
Wow. Right, all together.
Yeah.
And all of the same image pretty much. All of the farm a view from the farm or the farmhouse itself.
So it's a neat thing. But
yeah. And it'll help us with publicity because it's a hook for a lot of newspapers and we're hoping to get the word out through them. Already that American Art Review magazine.
That's a serious thing.
Interested in it.
That's so a really serious thing.
We know the reporter will be interested
you
in
know,
it.
How soon do you need this signature on the other paint? I want to paint the requirements.
Oh, before May would be great. But we can... I'm doubting there'll be a problem with it. So I can make up a form pretty quickly.
We meet the first Monday of May. Wednesday of May.
First Wednesday of May? Okay.
But I did find out there's one Lester Stevens quote that found out an interview where they asked him why he moved to Conway, and I just want to leave you with this happy thought, and that is that he said because he's been all over the country and the fall color in Conway is the best in the country.
Mm.
That's great.
So,
I love it.
Isn't that cool?
And he did hike around too. He looked all through Western Massachusetts for a place to live. You know, they like this.
Okay. Any other questions? All right, I'll make a motion that we lend the Lester Stevens paintings to the Historical Society from June 13th through June 19th for exhibition in the Field Memorial Library during the celebration of the 250th, except for number 8, which has been scratched off the list. All the others are owned by the town. Mm-hmm. All right. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
And number 8, that's the one that's owned by the Firemen's Auxiliary. Okay.
Thanks for clarifying that. Mm-hmm.
Hi.
Come in.
I don't know if this is appropriate. May I get your comment?
Come in.
Thank you. I wanted to have a moment where I would be able to talk to somebody, all of you. I don't know how long I need to wait or anything, but this is regarding the warrant, which I'm hoping isn't out yet.
The warrant has been finalized, yes.
Yes.
There's a pretty big mistake, and I wanted to point it out to you, and I was wondering if there's something you might be able to do with it. This is regarding the AgCom.
Yeah. We'll depart.
Well,
thank you so much.
Let me give you one of these.
Oh, sure. Thank you.
Yeah. You can let me know what the problem is, and I can work on what needs to be done about it.
Okay.
Does the AgCom know about it?
Yes.
Okay, then.
I downloaded it from the website.
Yeah, okay. Well, we can deal with that at town meeting then. So we have plenty of time. But they'll have to make a motion to amend on the floor.
Can you make us a copy down here?
You don't want to know what it is that's the problem?
Bill, Peter, thanks for coming in.
Thanks so much.
We can do that later.
Okay. Get the form?
Or I can put you on the agenda on Monday.
For next Monday?
I mean, we can do this outside of the meeting.
All right.
You
can put me on the agenda.
Is it the printer?
Yeah. It's already been printed.
Yeah.
Well, that doesn't mean that there couldn't be some comment.
They'll have to make an amendment at town meeting, which is in a month. So we have plenty of time to...
I think clarification would be maybe a more appropriate word.
Okay. Well, they can... whatever happens is going to... if there's any change, will have to happen at town meeting.
When we're actually voting?
Yes.
Are you saying?
Well, there'll be a discussion before we vote.
Yeah. That's when it takes place.
Yeah.
That's unfortunate. All right.
So feel free to send in, be in touch with me about what that is.
Okay.
So we can prepare.
Okay, next item on the agenda is to sign the MassDOT 10-year Chapter 90 contract. Okay, this is a standard contract that we do with them every couple of years. Now it's going to be 10 years, Tom?
Yeah.
What did it used to be, every 3 years?
I don't know. I've never run across it before.
Yes, okay. It was.
It was 3 years?
Does this have to be voted on town meeting? The last 3-year contracts we had to be voted on town meeting for. When I was superintendent. They had to prove it. Town meeting had to prove it.
All this does is allow us to get Chapter 90 funds.
Yes.
That's all. Okay. Yeah, let's just, I'll make a motion that we approve this. This MassDOT standard contract for 10 years, Chapter 90 contract.
There's no dollar amounts in there, is there, John?
No, there's no. It's just the fact that we're going to get money over the next 10 years, Chapter 90 funds.
And I can check with town council about that.
Yeah. All right. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Tom, do you want to give us your update on signing the rest of these?
In committee news, the Energy Committee notably Bryce Hereford, has been instrumental in the insulation and air sealing in Town Hall, which is almost finished. Not quite, there's still going to be some blowing some cellulose in. There were some inconveniences as the odor of the chemicals necessitated the closing of the building for 2 days, last Tuesday and this past Saturday, but we're over that now and winding down. The plan is to perform another blower door test once the work is done and measure the difference from which we can calculate savings.
And did those issues get resolved that Bob was asking about? Did you go look at it?
I talked to one of the workers. He said they were going to be doing it the next day. I haven't been over there to site to check to see if it was done. But
it was great.
He said it was going to be done, so.
Yeah.
Great.
The Historical Commission has requested some consultation with Town Council regarding the United Congregational Church, and I've given Sarah Williams Town Council's contact information. They have a number of questions about their role in that process.
Okay.
Parks and Recreation has been preparing the ball field for use, and some additional soil is slated to be delivered soon to be mixed in with the existing soil.
Good choice of words.
Slated there, yes, Tom. I like that.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I didn't know.
It's there. The soil's there.
Oh, okay.
He dropped it right at the bottom of the driveway, right on the grass. Big, huge pile.
Oh. Should have been on a tarp.
But I haven't seen a tarp.
Maybe it wasn't. And I believe the candidate for planning board, Beth Gershman, will be interested in serving on the Mohawk Trail Woodlands Partnership, the position Jim Moore had taken earlier. The COG has been looking for people for that position, so we now have somebody who is up for election to the planning board. She's an associate member now, and she's interested in serving on that.
Okay.
I've sent reminders to the Finance Committee and the Capital Improvements Planning Committee to review the long-term financial plan, and I encourage you to do the same. Perhaps we can have it for discussion on next week's agenda. Comments should be in to Joe Markarian by the end of the month, which is the end of next week, in preparation for a final revision and votes from all three bodies.
Can you just double-check with Jenny about that date I told you in those 3 days?
For mailing?
Mailing out a special warrant? She would know to answer that, probably.
And the bylaws are, of course, also on our website. For departmental news, the town report and warrant are printed and have been delivered to the mailhouse for preparation. I plan to pick them up Thursday or Friday morning and deliver them to the Conway, Shelburne Falls, and Williamsburg post offices. So they should be out before the weekend.
Yeah.
People might get them on Saturday, might not be till the following Monday, but even that's two weeks before town meeting.
Right. That's really good, Tom.
So we were able to get that done. The highway superintendent is finalizing an agreement for design work to be done for the North Poland Road Bridge that is in poor shape. We may be able to repair it for much less than the cost of replacement. So the design work will determine that, but he's still working on exactly the scope of the design work. So I just wanted to give an update that's good. Still in process, and it's moving forward. The only news about town meeting, I'm now working on motions for the warrant articles. I still have a question on the one for the non-binding resolution on having a vote next year for the highway garage, and I'm consulting with town council on that. But aside from that, they're in good shape.
Great.
Good. Thank you, Tom. Next item, concerns of the selectmen. We have any concerns? No concerns. Okay. Mail. All right. We have a notice in the mail from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. It's an announcement. Please join Energy and Environmental Secretary Matthew Beaton for an announcement of the Baker-Polito administration's Municipal Vulnerability Preparedness Program to assist communities in preparing for climate change by building resilience. And that is on Wednesday, April 19th, which is tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
At 10 a.m. Bridge of Flowers on the Buckland side. Ceremony adjacent to 16 State Street, Shelburne Falls. And there's some contact information on here. Tom, you have all this, right?
Yes. Okay. And I had been planning to attend.
Good.
Apparently there will be grants attached to this. There's going to be a two-phase process to the program, one that the COG will be mostly involved with and one that will be available to towns to work with the COG.
So I'm hoping to go to it too.
Good.
So,
oh, good.
And it may be an interesting rally because there are also there's an anti-pipeline rally at the Buckland side of the Bridge of Flowers at 10 o'clock.
Intentional?
At the same time?
I presume so.
Pretty cool. Changed as far as I'm concerned.
So the people I've talked to who are doing the rally assure me it will be a silent rally with some just people holding signs, but no one will say anything. So.
Okay.
But yes, it hopefully won't be a confrontation. But it's intended to be a confrontation because the anti-pipeline people are upset that the state is supporting the cutting down of trees in the Oda State Forest, which is due to happen at any day. And so that's why the rally's being held.
Make sure you keep yourself safe tomorrow, Bob. And you too, Tom.
We're going to see you on the
I'm not saying what side I'm on. I mean, the resiliency is all based upon work that UMass did, and it's really excellent work, and I'm glad the state is supporting it.
Don't get involved in any physical confrontations.
There will be.
Okay.
I'm assured there will be none of that.
We don't want to see your name on a front page.
No, I do not either.
Or on the back page.
You know?
But I just wanted you to know that it was happening.
Okay. Thank you, Bob. We have an email from the Friends of Peru State Forest. And let's see, it's about the Mohawk Trail Woodlands Partnership, the rural economic development from a public policy perspective. And there is a meeting about this on Monday, May 15th. That's plenty of time for now.
Yeah, and apparently this is a group that's opposed to the Mohawk Trail Woodlands Partnership.
They're opposed to it. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Mm.
So, and I learned that after I got that.
So there's plenty of time for this. We can post this on the site somewhere so people know. It's May 15th from 6 to 8 p.m. Light supper. Please forward to your select boards, health boards, and other interested town boards and officials. Okay, that's another piece of mail. And we have something from, this is the following email opt-out in service. What is this about?
Ah, yes, that Will Cody has over the last year had several suggestions about how to improve the website and allow people to get notifications from various pages when it's changed. And we are redesigning the website. Assures me that this is entirely possible to do within our redesign.
It's a technical issue that Roy can probably work on?
Yes.
Good.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, any announcements?
I have two announcements.
Oh, you do?
I do.
Oh,
so
please.
They'll be short.
Good ones?
And they're related. Yes, they're good ones. They're related to each other. And so one of them is I got a letter from Comcast that basically said they believe the wiring, the extension of the Conway network, and little puzzling, the letter was really focused on Conway as opposed to the other eight towns that are part of the extension, but it said they expect all of the work in Conway will be done right about the end of summer.
The end of this summer.
So this is earlier than we expected, and they said it's going very well. They're getting a lot of support from the NBI, who's the state is helping pressure Verizon to jump right on the pole work, and that the pole work turns out it's much less than anyone imagined. The poles are pretty unpopulated compared with the poles that Verizon is used to working on, so there's plenty of room to put the Comcast wiring on without doing a lot of moving of wires and things like that. So
this was originally supposed to be finished by the end of this year?
Maybe next year. Yeah.
So it could be 9 months or a year ahead of schedule.
That's right. 21st.
I'm not saying that. So I assume that the little letter was focused on Conway. It's only because it came to me, and I wrote to my other broadband chairs and asked them, and some of them have gotten letters and some haven't, and nobody knows why that is, but I don't know. So that's one thing. So that's excellent news. The other thing is, this coming Saturday, Comcast is doing a community service event. They're cleaning up the YMCA's Camp Apex in Shelburne. So this is really letting anyone watching this who might be interested, this cleanup will occur starting at 8 o'clock in the morning. And I like the Y. We have a relationship with Comcast. So I'm gonna go. And I sent a letter out to many of the people who have been the most interested in the extension, saying this is a great opportunity for people of Conway to come to Camp Apex and meet Comcast employees and make sure we talk to them about how important this is and to build a relationship, which to me is a good thing.
Good thing.
Absolutely.
So Saturday morning, 8 o'clock, Camp Apex. That's right on Shelburne, halfway between Shelburne Falls and Greenfield, on the north side of Route 2. Mm-hmm. It's just past that apple orchard.
Right.
Place where they sell food and things.
Right.
Corn on the cob. Yep. So that'll go from 8 o'clock to 2 o'clock. Comcast is providing breakfast at 8 o'clock. They're providing lunch at 1 o'clock. It's not going to be a heavy day of work, but to me it's an excellent opportunity for people to meet Comcast employees.
Networking.
And network.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yep.
So
great idea.
So talking about it in the board meeting today right now just was too good an opportunity to pass up.
Well, That's great.
If anybody has a question, they can write me. I'm happy to talk to them about it.
Okay. Good.
Great.
Any other business to come before the board? No. Okay, our next meeting is scheduled for next Monday, April 24th, here in the town offices at 6 o'clock. I'll make a motion to adjourn. Got a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Right.
Okay.